Assalamu alaikum students, a very good morning to you all. I hope you all are fine and doing great. Yesterday we started a very important topic, that was antimycobacterial drugs. These drugs are really important from examination point of view and clinically as well, because mycobacterial infection, especially tuberculosis, is very common in our part of the world. So let's get started. Mycobacterial infections are basically of three types. Tuberculosis, which is produced by Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Leprosy, the causative agent is Mycobacterium leprae. And atypical mycobacterial infections, which are also known as non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections. So we'll be discussing all these infections in details, but first of all, we'll complete tuberculosis, because you have started tuberculosis yesterday. We'll complete the first line drugs today and the second line in drugs used to treat leprosy and atypical mycobacterial infections will be covered on Monday, inshallah. Professor Saab started the anti-tuberculous drugs yesterday he has discussed the history of the disease, the signs and symptoms, diagnosis, the history of the drugs, the prevalence and the importance of the disease in detail, so I won't be repeating that. You are done with isoniazid as well, so we'll be doing the remaining drugs. So let's check out today's learning objectives first. By the end of today's lecture, you should be able to enumerate the first line and second line drugs used to treat tuberculosis. I want you to write down these points. Please keep your notebooks and pen by your side and note down the important university questions. This question often comes in exam, that enumerate first and second line anti-tuberculous drugs, and it is a very mathematical question. You just have to memorize the name of the drugs and you will get full marks. Then you get a question about the mechanism of action and resistance of different anti-tubercular drugs. Mechanism of action of all the first line drugs is really important, and resistance of isoniazid is more important as compared to rest of the drugs. The clinical uses of rifampin is really important, because rest of the drugs, they are only used to treat tuberculosis or other mycobacterial infections, but rifampin has a lot of clinical uses, so it is an important university question. Adverse effects of all the anti-tuberculous drugs is really, really important. And recommended regimens for the treatment of tuberculosis is often asked in your exams. So please write down these questions. They are very important from examination point of view. So the drugs used in tuberculosis, there are first line drugs and second line drugs. The first line drugs, they are more efficacious and they have lesser adverse effects as compared to the second line drugs. And they are cheaper as compared to the second line drugs as well. So the first line agents are isoniazid, rifampin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide and streptomycin. This is a mnemonic which is used to memorize the names of these drugs. It is RIPES, rifampin or rifampicin, isoniazid, pyrazinamide, ethambutol and streptomycin. In some books or in some literature, streptomycin is included in the first line drugs, whereas in others it is included in the second line drugs. So both are correct, because you can give the reference of any of your books. In a few books, streptomycin is a first line agent, and in others it is a second line agent. And if you recall, streptomycin is an aminoglycoside. So all these drugs can be given orally except streptomycin, because the aminoglycosides, they are highly polar and they cannot be given orally, so they are given parenterally, either through IV or intramuscular route. Clear? So you have been told yesterday that for centuries, TB was considered to be a very lethal disease, a lethal infectious disease. But with the introduction of the drugs like streptomycin and isoniazid in the late 1940s and rifampin and ethambutol in 1960 and pyrazinamide, the invention of these drugs or the discovery of these drugs, it revolutionized the treatment of tuberculosis, and it was then regarded as the treatable infectious disease. But unfortunately, this is not true today, because a lot of resistance has been developed against these drugs, not just to a single drug, but multi-drug resistance, extended drug resistance, and now even total drug resistance also emerged in some countries like India, Iran, and Italy. So it's really alarming. So you have to memorize the name of the first line drugs. As you were told earlier that to understand the chemotherapy well, you must have a sound knowledge of microbiology. So before starting today's session, I want you to have a clear picture of a mycobacterium in your mind. Just like other bacteria, it has a cell wall and a cell membrane. Its cell wall is made up of peptidoglycan like gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, but it has two different structures in its cell wall, mycolic acids and arabinogalactan. And these are the potential targets of anti-tuberculous drugs. And you know, it has a very thick lipid layer in its cell wall. It has a waxy cell wall. So isoniazid inhibits mycolic acid synthesis, and ethambutol, it inhibits the polymerization of arabinogalactan, and thus these two drugs are inhibiting the cell wall synthesis. We'll discuss only the first line antituberculous drugs today. So all the first line antituberculous drugs are tuberculosidal except for ethambutol, which is tuberculostatic. Tuberculosidal or tuberculocidal drugs are those which are killing the mycobacteria. You are done with isoniazid, so we'll be doing the remaining first line antituberculous drugs today. So the first drug for today's discussion is rifampin. It is also known as rifampicin. It is a semi-synthetic derivative of rifamycin and is produced by bacteria Amycolitopsis rifamycinica, which was previously known as Streptomyces mediterranei or Mediterranei. And apart from affecting mycobacteria, it is also active against gram-positive and gram-negative cocci, including staphylococci, meningococci, some enteric bacteria, and chlamydia as well. So it is having a lot of clinical indications. Rifamycin compounds, they are rifampin and rifabutin and rifapentin. Rifabutin and rifapentin are the second line antituberculous drugs, and we'll discuss them later on. So rifampin is well absorbed after oral administration, and its oral and parenteral preparations are available. It is widely distributed to body fluids, tissues, and phagocytic cells, and it also kills organisms which are inaccessible to other drugs, like the mycobacteria which is present intracellularly or in the lung abscesses or cavities. And it is excreted mainly through liver and bile, and also undergoes enterohepatic recirculation, and small amount of drug is excreted in urine. But dose adjustment is not required in renal or hepatic insufficiency. It is relatively highly protein bound, and adequate CSF level in meningeal inflammation is reached. So it can cross the blood-brain barrier if the meninges are inflamed, like in case of tuberculous meningitis. Its mechanism of action is really important. It penetrates into the mycobacteria and it inhibits the bacterial DNA dependent RNA polymerase and thus inhibits RNA synthesis of bacteria. But it is highly selective for the bacterial RNA polymerase, and rifampin does not bind the human RNA polymerase and does not inhibit RNA synthesis in humans. And it is bactericidal for mycobacteria. So isoniazid was inhibiting the mycolic acid synthesis, and rifampin is inhibiting the bacterial DNA dependent RNA polymerase and RNA synthesis. Resistance develops due to mutation in genes for RNA polymerase, and this is RPOB gene, which encodes the RNA polymerase and reduces its binding to rifampin if its gene gets mutated. Cross resistance to other rifamycin derivatives like rifabutin and rifapentin is there, but there is no cross resistance to any other antimicrobial drug. Okay, so it is inhibiting DNA dependent RNA polymerase, and resistance is due to mutations in the genes encoding for RNA polymerase. If you can memorize the name of the gene, well and good. If not, don't write a wrong name. Now its clinical uses. As you were told earlier, it has antimicrobacterial uses and other antibacterial uses as well, because it is active against gram-positive, gram-negative cocci and bacilli as well. So it is used in combination with second agent for active tuberculosis. As you have been told earlier, that resistance to these drugs develops really quickly. So none of these drugs is given as a single agent for the treatment of active tuberculosis. They are always given in a combination therapy. So it is one of the drugs used to treat active tuberculosis, but in combination with other drugs. It is also used to treat atypical mycobacterial infections, to treat leprosy. So it is basically used to treat all kinds of mycobacterial infections. And it can also be used as an alternative to isoniazid for patients with latent tuberculosis who are unable to take isoniazid, or they are exposed to isoniazid resistant strain. So it is also used for the treatment of latent tuberculosis or for prophylaxis of tuberculosis. So if isoniazid and rifampin, both of them can be used for the treatment of latent tuberculosis. And the dose of rifampin is 10 mg per kg per day, and the dose of isoniazid was 5 mg per kg per day. Clear? And it is given for 6 months. So antimicrobacterial uses were, it is used for treatment of active tuberculosis, for treatment of latent tuberculosis, but as an alternative to isoniazid. Isoniazid is always the first choice for the treatment of latent tuberculosis, for atypical mycobacterial infections and for treatment of leprosy. So it is also used for the treatment of other bacterial infections, like it is used for prophylaxis in H influenza type B contacts, to eliminate meningococcal carrier state. It is also used to eradicate the staphylococcal carriers. Those are the nasal carriers, and it is responsible for recurrent furunculosis. But it is given in combination with the second agent for the eradication of staphylococcal carriage. And it is also used to treat serious staphylococcal infection, especially with vancomycin. It is used to treat osteomyelitis, prostatic valve, endocarditis. Clear? So, it is used for prophylaxis of H influenza type B contacts, to eliminate meningococcal and staphylococcal carrier state, and in combination therapy, especially with vancomycin, for serious staphylococcal infection. Clear? These were its antimicrobacterial and antibacterial uses. Now the adverse effects of rifampin. The most common adverse effect of rifampin is harmless orange colored secretions. It imparts orange color to urine, sweat and tears because it produces orange colored metabolites, and the contact lenses can be permanently stained. So it is really important to educate the patient that when he'll start rifampin, his secretions might get orange colored, and it is a very typical orange color, like color of Fanta or Mirinda. So you have to tell him, otherwise he'll be frightened to see his urine orange or his tears to be orange in color. Then rashes, thrombocytopenia and light chain proteinuria also occur occasionally, nephritis, cholestatic jaundice, hepatitis. These are some of the common adverse effects of rifampin. And all these first line agents except for ethambutol and streptomycin, they produce hepatotoxicity, and especially they derange the liver function tests. So we have to monitor the liver function tests. So before starting the therapy, we always get a baseline LFT so that we have a baseline to compare the changes in the LFTs. Clear? If it is given in high doses for a shorter duration of time, it can produce a flu-like syndrome, which is characterized by fever, chills, malaise, anemia, thrombocytopenia, and occasionally it can produce acute renal tubular necrosis. So So these are the adverse effect, but the most common one is the harmless orange colored secretions, and you often get this question in your exam in MCQs or SEQs. And the second one is light chain proteinuria. So it is a potent cytochrome P450 inducer. It increases the elimination of methadone, anticoagulants, cyclosporin, anticonvulsants, protease inhibitors, non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. These are anti-HIV drugs and contraceptives. So you know the drugs which are either cytochrome P450 inducers or inhibitors, they end up in a lot of drug interactions. So if any of these drugs is given with rifampin, its blood levels will fall because it is increasing its metabolism and it is increasing its elimination. So especially you are asked about the contraceptives and these anti-HIV drugs, because most of the patients who are having tuberculosis, they can have HIV simultaneously, and if they are on these drugs, what would be your preference? So in that cases, we give other rifamycin derivatives. We don't give rifampin because it is a potent cytochrome P450 inducer. And if a female has active tuberculosis and she is given rifampin and she is on oral contraceptives, you have to educate her that she has to change the mode of contraception. She cannot take oral contraceptives because they won't be effective in that case, as it is increasing its elimination. And if you recall, isoniazid was a potent cytochrome P450 inhibitor. So we are done with rifampin. Now ethambutol, it is a synthetic water soluble and heat stable compound. This is its chemical structure. It is well absorbed from GIT and only oral preparation is available. 20% of the drug is excreted in feces and 50% in urine in unchanged form. Ethambutol accumulates in renal failure, therefore its dose has to be reduced in cases of renal failure, and it crosses blood-brain barrier when meninges are inflamed. It inhibits mycobacterial arabinosyl transferases, and these enzymes are required for the polymerization of arabinoglycan. And as we saw earlier, arabinoglycan is an essential component of mycobacterial cell wall. So it is inhibiting the enzyme arabinosyl transferase and thus inhibits the polymerization of arabinoglycan. Resistance develops due to mutations in EMB gene if the drug is used alone. It is bacteriostatic. All other first-line drugs, they are bactericidal, and it is used in combination with isoniazid or rifampin for active tuberculosis and in higher doses for tuberculous meningitis. And it is also used in combination with other agents for atypical mycobacterial infections like Mycobacterium avium complex or Mycobacterium kansasi infection. So it has basically two uses, that it is used in the treatment of active tuberculosis along with other drugs, and it is also used for the treatment of atypical mycobacterial infections. Retrobulbar neuritis is the most common adverse effect of ethambutol, which is characterized by red-green color blindness and decreased visual acuity. Ethambutol starts with E, so it produces adverse effects in eye. Periodic visual acuity testing is recommended. So a baseline and periodic visual acuity and color discrimination testing is advised to the patient to check for this adverse effect. Hypersensitivity like fever, drug fever and rash is really rare. This adverse effect is dose dependent. And the dosage of ethambutol is 15 to 25 milligram per kg per day. So if we'll reduce the dose or we'll stop the drug, the adverse effect will disappear. And ethambutol is contraindicated in very young children, especially in children less than 5 years of age. Can you think why is it contraindicated in children less than 5 years of age? because we cannot assess the visual acuity in kids, and especially the kids of 1 or 2 years of age, they can't tell about the red or green color as well. So we usually avoid ethambutol in kids less than 5 years of age. So this was the most common adverse effect, that was red green color blindness and decreased visual acuity. Ethambutol can also produce pruritus, which is itching, hyperuricemia, because it decreases the excretion of uric acid. Therefore, it can produce arthralgias, GI upset, abdominal pain, malaise, headache, dizziness, mental confusion, disorientation, and hallucinations when it crosses the blood-brain barrier. So these are the adverse effects, but the most common one was the decreased visual acuity, and red-green color discrimination is also decreased. Now, pyrazinamide, it is a relative of nicotinamide. It is stable and slightly soluble in water. It is inactive at neutral pH but active in acidic pH. It is taken up by macrophages and is active against intracellular organisms that may cause relapse. Isoniazid, rifampin, and ethambutol, they were active against intracellular as well as extracellular organisms, but pyrazinamide is only active against intracellular organisms because it is active in acidic pH. This is its structure. Pyrazinamide is well absorbed from GIT and only its oral preparation is available. It is widely distributed in body tissues including inflamed meninges, and its half-life is 8 to 11 hours. Parent compound is metabolized by liver, and metabolites are renally cleared, especially through glomerular filtration. Pyrazinamide is only active against Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and the dose is 25 mg per kg per day. Pyrazinamide is first activated by mycobacterial pyrazinamidase to pyrazinoic acid within the acidic environment of lysosomes. As we discussed earlier, that it is active against the intracellular mycobacteria, and it gets activated in the acidic environment of lysosomes. So after getting activated, it disrupts the mycobacterial cell membrane metabolism and transport functions, and it is bactericidal. It is active against only Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Clear? So first of all, it is activated by pyrazinamidase to pyrazinoic acid, which disrupts mycobacterial cell membrane metabolism and transport functions. Resistance can develop due to impaired uptake of pyrazinamide or due to mutations in gene of enzyme required for its activation, that was pyrazinamidase, and the name of the gene is PNCA. It produces hepatotoxicity, as we already discussed that all of the first line anti-tuberculous drugs except for ethambutol, they produce hepatotoxicity, so we have to monitor liver function tests. It can produce hyperuricemia and thus may provoke acute gouty arthritis. If the hyperuricemia is asymptomatic, there is no need to stop the drug, and we have to monitor the levels of uric acid as well. Produces arthralgia, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, drug fever, and photosensitivity. The main adverse effect is hyperuricemia and hepatotoxicity and arthralgia. Now, streptomycin. Streptomycin is only available in injectable preparation. It is given either intramuscularly or intravenously, and the dose is 15 mg per kg per day. It poorly penetrates into the cells, and it crosses the blood-brain barrier if meninges are inflamed. So all the first-line anti-tuberculous drugs are used in the treatment of tuberculous meningitis. And it is active mainly against the extracellular bacilli. It is also active against non-tuberculous mycobacterial species like Mycobacterium avium complex and Mycobacterium kensasi. But this is not very practical, because if you have to give the drug to the patient for 2 months, he'll have to get an intramuscular injection daily for 2 months. It is really painful. You're already done with streptomycin. It is an aminoglycoside, and all the aminoglycosides, they inhibit protein synthesis by binding to the 30S ribosomal subunit, and they cause misreading of genetic code during translation. So this is its mechanism of action. Resistance develops due to alteration in ribosomal binding site. And the main adverse effects are ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity. In ototoxicity, there is vertigo and irreversible hearing loss. You are done with aminoglycosides in detail, so I won't be discussing it again. You only need to know that streptomycin is also a first-line anti-tuberculous drug. And since it is nephrotoxic, so we have to monitor RFTs. So we are done with the first line anti-tuberculous agent that were isoniazid, rifampin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide and streptomycin. I want you to just go through the names of the second line agents, and this is your homework to memorize their names at weekend, and on Monday you should know their names by heart. Okay, so there are a lot of drugs which can be used as second line agents in the treatment of tuberculosis, and obviously if a person is not tolerating the first line drugs, or if the mycobacteria is not susceptible to the first line drug, the mycobacteria is resistant to the first line drugs, then we switch to the second line agents, or we add the second line agents to the regimen. So these drugs are ethionamide, rifabutin, rifapentin, these are rifamycin derivatives, cycloserine and carbapenems, these are cell wall synthesis inhibitors, and you are done with the cell wall synthesis inhibitors. Carbapenems were meropenem, imipenem, artipenem and foropenem. Then capreomycin, amikacin, kanamycin, these are aminoglycosides, and these are the injectable second line agents. Linezolid is protein synthesis inhibitor. Moxifloxacin, levofloxacin and ciprofloxacin are fluoroquinolones. Moxifloxacin is the most active antituberculous drug, followed by levofloxacin and then ciprofloxacin. Then aminosalicylic acid, it is folate antagonist. Bidaquiline, clofazimine, delaminid and pretominid. These are the second line agents and you need to memorize them. There is a mnemonic face park, F, fluoroquinolones, these moxifloxacin, levofloxacin, ciprofloxacin, A, aminoglycosides, capreomycin, amikacin, kanamycin, C, these cell wall synthesis inhibitors, cycloserine and carbapenems, C is cell wall synthesis inhibitors, E, ethionamide, P, paraaminosalicylic acid, or rifabutin and rifapentin, and C is clofazimine. So you can use this mnemonic to memorize the names of these second line agents. Clear? So the greatest fear today is the development of resistance to antituberculous drugs. And as we discussed earlier, if a patient is resistant only to isoniazid, then you can give him rifampin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide. If he is resistant only to rifampin, we can give other drugs. Isoniazid and rifampin are the most active antituberculous drug, but the problem is the development of multi-drug resistance tuberculosis. In multi-drug resistance tuberculosis, the mycobacteria is resistant to isoniazid and rifampin both. And the next problem that has developed is extended drug resistance tuberculosis. And in extended drug resistance tuberculosis, in addition to resistance to isoniazid and rifampin, the mycobacteria develops resistance to fluoroquinolones and to any one of the injectable second line agents. Now, since the total drug resistance has emerged in a few countries, so it is really, really alarming, because no drug can treat those patients. and it's really a very serious issue. And you know why the resistance develops? If the patient is not taking the drug properly, the regimen is not proper, or the compliance is very poor. That's why government has initiated, it has taken an initiative and has developed many programs, including the National Tuberculosis Program and DOTS therapy, in which a healthcare worker, he goes to the person's home and he gives the drug himself to the patient to avoid resistance. To avoid resistance, at least two or more agents in combination should always use to treat active tuberculosis. That is the case for single drug resistance. Clear? So now you know what is single drug resistance, what is multi-drug resistance, what is extended drug resistance, and what is total drug resistance tuberculosis. As you know that tuberculosis is a chronic infection, so the response of mycobacterial infections to chemotherapy is very slow, and treatment must be administered for months to years depending upon which drugs are used. Unlike other bacterial infections in which we just give treatment for 1 week or maximum of 2 weeks. So months or years of treatment is required for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and the treatment is divided usually into two phases, the initial or initiative phase and initial or the intensive phase, in which four drugs are given for 2 months, and then the continuation phase in which two drugs, basically isoniazid and rifampin, are given for 4 months. So 6 months is minimum for the treatment of tuberculosis. But in case of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the treatment may extend to 9 months or a year. Government has taken an initiative by creating a program that is known as the National TB Control Program, and its mission is to decrease the 50% of prevalence of TB in general population by 2025 in comparison to 2012, and achieving zero TB death. And government is really working hard. The drugs are given to the patients free of cost, and healthcare workers, they also visit the patients and they check whether they are taking the drugs properly or not. So that's really a good program. These are different regimens, and you can see that if we give only two drugs, we have to give the treatment for a year or year and a half, and if we give three drugs, we can give the treatment for 6 months, especially isoniazid, rifampin, pyrazinamide, or rifampin, ethambutol, and pyrazinamide. And if we give isoniazid, rifampin only, then we have to give the treatment for 9 months, and if rifampin, ethambutol, or isoniazid, ethambutol, then for 12 or 18 months respectively. In Pakistan, fixed drug combinations are available, like Myrin-P, which contains isoniazid, rifampin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol in a single tablet, and Myrin, which contains isoniazid, rifampin, and ethambutol in a single tablet. So this is really good to ensure the compliance, because taking four different drugs daily for 6 months or a year is really a tough job. So this is really a good preparation. And these fixed combinations are usually not available in Middle Eastern countries and in US and UK, but they are available in Pakistan and India. But it is a very big tablet and it is very difficult to take it. These drugs are usually taken before meals, especially before breakfast, and they produce a lot of nausea and can produce vomiting as well. You have to emphasize the importance of treatment to the patient, and you have to tell him that he cannot even miss a single dose of the drug. If he's having nausea, he can take the drug with some juice like pineapple juice or mango juice. It will decrease the incidence of nausea, and you should tell the patient about the development of resistance and how important it is to take the drug for every day for 6 months or a year or 1.5 years, depending upon the situation of the patient. Clear? That's your duty, to inform the patient about all the adverse effects, about the importance of the drug drugs and importance of the treatment of the disease, about the development of resistance, you need to tell your patient about it. And if you think that the patient's compliance will be poor, you can enroll him into the DOTS therapy so that the healthcare worker, he will make sure that the person is taking the drug. Well, this is the most commonly used regimen, in which four drugs, isoniazid, rifampin, pyrazinamide and ethambutol, are given for 2 months daily, and then isoniazid and rifampin is given for 4 months daily. This is the preferred regimen. This is the DOTS therapy. DOT therapy was directly observed therapy, short duration therapy, in which for the next 4 months, isoniazid and rifampin are given 3 days per week, because the healthcare visitor has to go to the patient's house and he has to give the drug to the patient himself. That's why it is given 3 days per week. If a patient was already having tuberculosis and she was taking treatment and she gets pregnant, she will continue her treatment if she's taking isoniazid, rifampin, ethambutol and pyrazinamide, because all these four drugs, they are safer in pregnancy as compared to the rest of the drugs. And streptomycin is not given in pregnancy because it is teratogenic. And if she gets tuberculosis during pregnancy, then again we'll start the treatment with these four drugs. And if the baby born is positive for tuberculosis, then we'll start the treatment. And if he is not having tuberculosis, then we'll give him isoniazid for 6 months for the prevention of tuberculosis. Clear? But if the patient is having multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, then isoniazid and paraminosalicylic acid was given initially, but we have different options. If she's having multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, we can start the treatment after the second trimester of pregnancy. We'll not start the treatment in first trimester of pregnancy, because most of the second line agents, they are contraindicated in pregnancy. And therapeutic abortion is also an option. The patient can terminate pregnancy if she's having multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Clear? And now about lactation. If she is, she has been taking medication for long and now she is no more infectious, she is no more contagious, then she can breastfeed the infant. But if the infant also had congenital tuberculosis and he's taking drugs for tuberculosis, then a mother should take her medication after the feed and should also give bottle feed to the infant, because all these drugs, they are excreted in milk. And if she's having tuberculosis of the lactiferous glands or ducts, then of course lactation would be contraindicated. And if she recently got tuberculosis and she is contagious, then again lactation would be contraindicated. Clear? So we are done with the first line agents. Now let's summarize them. The mnemonic for first line agents was RIPES: rifampin, isoniazid, pyrazinamide, ethambutol and streptomycin. Now let's check out their dose. You have to memorize their dose. Isoniazid 5 mg, rifampin 10 mg, ethambutol 15 to 25 mg, pyrazinamide 25 mg and streptomycin 15 mg per kg per day. All are tuberculosidal except ethambutol. Clear? They all are tuberculosidal except ethambutol. And if we talk about their mechanism of action, isoniazid was inhibiting the mycolic acid synthesis, rifampin was inhibiting RNA synthesis by inhibiting DNA-dependent RNA polymerase, and ethambutol was inhibiting the polymerization of arabinoglycan by inhibiting the arabinosyl transferase, and pyrazinamide, it was inhibiting the cell membrane transport function and its metabolism, and streptomycin is inhibiting RNA synthesis by binding to the 30S ribosomal subunit. Clear? Now their clinical uses. Isoniazid is used for the treatment of latent and active tuberculosis along with other drugs. Rifampin is used for the treatment of active tuberculosis, and in latent tuberculosis, if isoniazid cannot be used in atypical mycobacterial infections, for the treatment of leprosy, for the treatment of meningococcal and staphylococcal carrier states, for their eradication, and for the prophylaxis of H influenza B contacts, and for the treatment of staphylococcal infection, serious staphylococcal infections, right? And ethambutol, it was used for the treatment of active tuberculosis and for the treatment of atypical mycobacterial infections. Streptomycin is also used for the treatment of active tuberculosis and atypical mycobacterial infections, and pyrazinamide is used only for the treatment of active tuberculosis along with other drugs. Now their adverse effects. All are hepatotoxic except ethambutol and streptomycin. And apart from hepatotoxicity, what was the adverse effect of isoniazid? INH, neuropathy, the peripheral neuropathy, which is due to the deficiency of vitamin B6. So we always give vitamin B6 pyridoxine along with isoniazid. It produces CNS toxicity, hematological abnormalities, SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, and it inhibits cytochrome P450. Rifampin, red colored secretions were important, and then light chain protein urea, nephritis, flu-like syndrome, and it induces cytochrome P450. Ethambutol, retrobulbar neuritis, red-green discrimination, and decreased visual acuity. Pyrazinamide, hyperuricemia, polyarthralgia, photosensitivity. These were the common adverse effects of all these drugs. So this is the summary of first line antituberculous agents, and I hope you have understood them. So we are done with today's session, and now it's time for quiz. You have to write down the question number and its answer, and then submit it to your WhatsApp group for attendance. Don't write the question. A 60-year-old man presents to the ER with a 2-month history of fatigue, weight loss, he has lost 10 kgs in 2-month period, fever, night sweats, and a productive cough. All of these are the classical symptoms of pulmonary tuberculosis. He is currently living with friends and has been intermittently homeless, spending time in shelters. Since he is spending time in shelter, so he might have contacted tuberculosis from someone over there, and he is also an alcoholic. Chest x-ray shows a right apical infiltrate. His first sputum smear shows many acid-fast bacilli, and diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis is made. What drugs should be started for treatment of presumptive pulmonary tuberculosis? So before getting the culture and sensitivity report, which drugs will you start? And does the patient have a heightened risk of developing medication toxicity? And if so, which medications would be likely to cause toxicity? And if this patient was also having HIV, then which drug will you replace out of the 4 first line drugs? Now the MCQs. Don't write the statements of the MCQs, just write the question number and its correct answer. The primary reason for the use of drug combinations in the treatment of tuberculosis is to: the antitubercular agent most likely to interfere with the action of oral contraceptives is: a 10-year-old boy has uncomplicated pulmonary tuberculosis, and after initial hospitalization, he is now being treated at home with isoniazid, rifampin, and ethambutol. Which statement about this case is accurate? Well, that's all for today. If you have any question, you can ask me in your WhatsApp group and I'll get back to you as soon as possible. I hope you have understood the lecture well and you have understood the importance of tuberculosis and its management. So take care of yourselves Have a great day. Allah Hafiz.